Christopher Robin!
I walked across an empty land. I knew the pathway like the back of my hand.
We will have a contest to find a new tale for Eeyore.
I used to think that Winnie the Pooh was just a simple, sweet children's book, made even sweeter by the magic of Disney animation. Then I come to realize that all these characters are representative of drug addicts.
I thought there was a cross-section of America in general. You know, you've got like the guy who's just like, more, more, give it to me. The honey that rhymes with money.
you could say that, but I always saw Winnie the Pooh, he's a pothead. You know, he's real
a honey pothead.
he's more of a
no, I meant like weed, motherfuckers. He's smoking spliffs and waking up every day talking like this. And
he's more of a crack addict, actually, because I don't think I've ever met anyone on weed who, you know, actually starts to hallucinate, you know, just weed everywhere in their everything that they see. I see that more with crack addicts.
They do get that
starting
hungry
to foam at the mouth.
They do get that hungry.
Maybe his dealer has just been lacing his pot, because he does. He's all kind of sleepy and mellow. That's the thing about Winnie the Pooh, man. He is mellow.
He is mellow.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, he's got bees chasing him. He knows to run, but he's just like, hey man, it's all cool.
It's good.
Man,
do you have any honey on you?
It's good to finally have a kid's film that deals with addiction, though. That's what you're teaching these kids early on.
It also teaches them, like, hey, you got an addiction? It's all right, because somebody's going to hook you up.
Yeah, it's always. These animals are okay. They're all kind of dumb, but yet all of them have some. Al is a coke addict. He's a cokehead, because he's always talking like this about himself.
Yeah.
You know?
That's true. He's got delusions of grandeur.
Yeah.
He's always writing.
Eeyore is an alcoholic. Yeah. You know, he's depressed all the time.
He's clinically depressed. It's like, I wish somebody could help me find my tail. It's like, hey, why don't you look for your Prozac?
That guy's the ultimate emo. I was like, wow. How come they don't call emo kids emo? Or kids. That would make more sense.
And Tigger's a goddamn meth addict. I mean, Tigger even got meth face. You see how big his jaw is? His face is all sucked in.
I know, no teeth.
No teeth? Yeah.
Besides, if anyone was going to come out of a dark corner and jump on you, grab your wallet, it's going to be Tigger.
Give me your shit!
You got your wallet? Who robbed you? Some big striped, fuzzy, orange guy? He's spraying everywhere. Yeah, man, it's a... You know what? I hate to even talking like this.
I know, man. Why are you going to desecrate the 100-acre woods?
I know, man. This is...
God damn it, Corey.
I know. He got mad at me in the movie, because there's a part where Winnie the Pooh goes up to Al's house, and he's like, Al, do you have any honey? Just a little bit. Just a smidgen. Just a drop. And then I whisper to Leon. I said, I'll suck your dick. He's like, come on, man. This is Winnie the Pooh, man.
The children.
But that was funny what you said.
But like, you were thinking it. That's why I said it.
I wasn't thinking until you said it.
I thought every grown adult in that theater was thinking that. I mean,
when it was like the 18th time that they had dangled honey in front of Pooh's face, only to yank it away. Corey and I both got it at the same time. We're like, having Pooh go, this is some bullshit.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah, actually, he said that to me. You know, but I was thinking that for Winnie the Pooh, because I was like, he's been fiending for honey through this whole movie, and there's a part where he actually has it, and they just let it float away from him. I'm like, y'all know he's one of this shit, all right?
And y'all just go, look at him. And his reaction is priceless. I mean, he just
mauled
like
the shit out of him.
You know, just that one scene alone, I was like, that's what Winnie the Pooh is all about, right there.
Winnie the Pooh is about, really, it's about loss and just being able to deal with it. Mm-hmm. You know, smoke a spliff, you'll be all right.
Yeah, no.
It is about having a band of wacky friends. Much like you guys, and just learn to just deal with their idiosyncrasies.
All right.
Well, I hate even reading into this so much, because this is Disney's. I think that they're probably the most endearing and lasting franchise as far as being able to just retain its simplicity over the ages and still work. I mean,
its dignity.
The last movie that came out was in 2005. It was like the Hufflepuff movie. I never saw it, but I heard like critics were just going crazy over it.
Well, after seeing this, like before, I was like, how could you? After seeing this, I was like, okay, I can believe it. I haven't seen the movie either, but I can say it is weird how they've chosen, Disney has chosen this property to, like, you know, make money off of, make, you know, sequels and TV shows, and then still keep the integrity about it.
Well, it's very simple. I mean, there's as long as you don't try and go too crazy and too off of the core idea of what this is about and what these characters are about, then you're kind of safe. People constantly relate to the different personality types of each of the characters, and the way in the end, you know, despite their differences, their idiosyncrasies are just plain idiots, they all still get along. They do the right thing in the end every time. And the message, you know, like here, for instance, and a lot of these is like, look, put your friends first, and eventually the reward will come back to you anyway. Yeah. You know, it's like that Sting song.
Yeah. It's just nice to see that. It's just nice to see that nobody's trying to put him in like a red hoodie or anything like that, or trying to like make it more smart than it needs to be, or attempt to make it more urbanized or whatever you modernize it to the point where, you know, no, that you don't need to do any of that. There's a reason why, like I've said it before with a lot of other properties, there's a reason why these properties work.
Now, it's been a long time since I've seen one of these, but isn't the whole sort of fourth wall breaking concept in here new, though?
No.
If you go back and watch the
original Winnie the Pooh movie that they did, this is so close. It's really close without feeling like a ripoff or a retread. It's just like, it's a
continuation.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it, because it did a lot of the breaking the fourth wall, playing with the book.
Pooh left feeling unsatisfied and a little out of sorts. In fact, he was so distracted by his rumbly tummy that he didn't notice that he was walking onto the next paragraph.
What is a paragraph?
It's a group of sentences that form a complete thought.
Is there honey in this paragraph?
Oh, sorry, Pooh, no.
Well, then, I don't find it very useful.
Okay.
Being very creative.
I wasn't sure.
Because I've never seen any of these Winnie the Pooh movies ever. I don't think. I remember, like, some of the cartoons that they used to do.
Right.
But nothing that I'd, like, actually sit down and watch. So watching this, though, I was like, wow, this is actually clever. I mean, this is... I have to say, this is probably, like, one of the most interesting and by far one of the best animated films I've seen in a long time.
It's what they did with the first one. Like, it's been so long since I've seen it, but I was like, wow, I remember what I got out of it was how it was really clever, and they did it would be artsy and do really cool things, and you don't expect that from something like this, you know, a story about a bunch of stuffed animals that talk. But I was like, man, they really took advantage of it, and here they did it again.
And the humor, that is the one thing about this movie that really impressed me, was how they can keep the humor so simple and so good for like a kid to enjoy, and at the same time an adult to enjoy. Where I'm like, wow, you don't have to throw any kind of weird innuendos or anything like that to play up to the adults in the audience. Even though we all, you know, if you take enough time to really look, you can make up your own crazy shit. Even though I'm sure the filmmakers don't intend you to do that. But
innuendo? I mean, it's like two bears, one cup. I'm not sure. What you're
Well, I'm saying like
reference stuff we were saying before.
That they're all drug addicts.
Yeah.
Dependency problems.
Which I actually see in like a lot of like the newer animated films, like even Pixar. I mean, I see some things where it's like the kids won't understand with this, but you know, hey, here's something that looks like a dick.
And I know, here you go, Dad. I know you had to give up your Saturday to take your kids here, so here's a little something for you.
Yeah,
yeah. And you know something, you make a good point, because during this property has been around for years. It's gone through many incarnations. Disney, you know, as they promptly ganked this from the A.A. Milne or Milne, whatever books or series of stories. Milne.
Yeah.
Yeah, they pretty much, people forget that this was actually a series of stories, and they forget what the original illustrated Pooh looks like. Mm-hmm. Disney has pretty much stolen that and said, this is our shit.
You know? Right, right.
And when you think of Pooh, you're going to think of our Pooh.
Yeah, and correct me if I'm wrong, but these weren't necessarily so much kids' books, right?
They were.
The Dalaboo and stuff like that.
Maybe
which
that's what I'm
years
thinking
later
about.
Is a sort of like the philosophy that you can take out of Winnie the Pooh.
No, but these stories, especially in the Disney incarnation, were adopted by the hippie culture, I believe,
very much so
in the '60s. And today, you can even see that, because here in Austin, we have Eeyore's
birthday.
Yeah, we had
which
Eeyore's
is nothing
birthday.
But a bunch of funk ass hippies.
Yeah, a bunch of naked hippie girls hanging around.
Yeah, exactly.
Playing the drums. And I love it.
If Eeyore was there, he'd be sitting in the corner depressed, wanting to go home.
He'd be more depressed. Yeah.
He wouldn't be invited to the party.
Hey, man, cheer up.
That's the point where
it's freedom rock.
Yeah, get away from me, you fucking hippie.
Yeah, that's the one where. That's the one where Eeyore finally be in the corner talking about, God damn it. It's come to this.
Yeah. They didn't even invite me much to my own goddamn party.
Oh no, Eeyore's hung himself.
Yeah. Eeyore set himself
on
fire.
I've always thought of a t-shirt, and I would never be the one to do it, but I always thought of a t-shirt where you would see Eeyore's legs dangling from something, and Pooh Bear would be looking up, and the caption below would be, "Oh bother," because you do think like Eeyore's going. I want them to stop making these movies because they're gonna make the one where Eeyore offs himself.
Hey, you know what? I think co-host is right that Eeyore is just the emo. I mean, he's all depressed and everything, but he whines a little too much. I'm like,
he likes
attention.
Oh, he wants attention. Yeah. And he ain't that.
Always
sad.
Has to be about him and his damn tail.
I know. This is me one episode where this Pooh just slaps the shit out of him.
Just at the very least, they come on him and he's like cutting his legs.
He's a cutter too.
Stuffing coming out.
Oh my God.
He's got stitches all over him now.
Anybody noticing me? Please.
He's getting into Bauhaus.
Maybe. Yeah, right. Maybe that's Tigger. Maybe Tigger's actually a lion, not a tiger.
Actually be listening to Joy Division or something. Yeah. But yeah, you know, and it's always worked. I mean, no matter what Disney has done with this, and believe me, they've been making their money off of it, but it's been it was one of the first Saturday morning cartoons that came on that I thought, like, Disney has a Saturday morning cartoon, and actually looked good, and it worked as a Saturday morning cartoon. I know it might still be around. They have a CG version of Winnie the Pooh, which is kind of cool looking because it's based on, I think, actual motion capture in some scenes. And then they had one in the 80s.
When they did the one with puppets.
That was, you're thinking about the one where they, they did one with puppets. Yeah. And then they did one where they had people dressed up in costumes.
Jesus.
They have pimped out Pooh for decades.
But at the same time, as co-host pointed out, they didn't do to him, they didn't bend him over like they did with Bugs Bunny and change him into a hip hop rapper or a superhero.
Cyber superhero.
Yeah, cyber superhero.
No, this is one of the few properties that you will see over the decades that has, as you said, again, has retained his dignity. They realized that.
Ooh, he could be a Green Lantern.
Yeah.
Hey, Kilowog going, Poozers, come on.
Oh, God. I'm shocked that Disney didn't do that.
This is the one where they have realized, like, this works as it is. No matter how many of these stories that we tell, this continues to work. And for this one, this is actually supposed to be five stories in one. And they narrowed it down to three stories. I don't know. I've never read too many of these stories. I've read some when I was a kid, but I don't know which ones they were. And I don't know how they mixed them up.
What, you're saying this movie?
This movie is supposed to be a combination of three stories. I mean, five stories and narrowed it down to three. In fact, you're even supposed to see Rabbit's family in this. And
How do you know it's supposed to be all that stuff?
Read about it.
Okay.
Yeah,
it's Winnie the Pooh shortcuts or something. Robert Altman,
the old movie, it was that way. It might have been five stories.
Well, you know what? It was seamless because I couldn't tell.
It's kind of a rambling tale, but it's a good way that they, you know, take you from one to the next and link it all together.
Pretty focused within here. It never feels like, oh, here's a bunch of stories that come together. It's just, I mean, Eeyore loses his tail, and so everyone's like, well, we need to get together and find this tail. And Pooh's like, yeah, and we need to find that honey soon. No, the tail, Pooh. Yeah.
Well, that's how a lot of these start out.
That's the plot, right?
It seems random, but they tie it in because Pooh is fiending for honey one day, and him trying to find honey usually leads to a lot of other misadventures. And this movie goes anywhere from them trying to find a big creature called the Baxen, all the way to them trying to get out of a hole, and where you get to see just how pretty much stupid all these characters are. And there's a charm in that stupidity,
there's
stupid in the way, like, the Three Stooges are stupid.
Exactly.
So you're like, you know, it's done in a way that's funny. It's not like you're going like, you guys are morons and this is boring and I'm out of here. It's like, watch this movie, I'm like, wow, I forgot how much fun cartoonists can have when they're just like given, you know, the space to do it.
Oh yeah.
Just you know, it's a simple concept, but just make it funny. And just be playful with it.
And yet I kept as I was watching this, thinking to myself, I would kind of like to see this live action, but about the inmates from an escaped insane asylum, you know? I mean, like, harmless ones, but, like, you know, these guys are kind of mildly retarded, some of them. Other ones are, like, tripping schizophrenics and stuff, and they're having these wacky adventures
you
out
see?
In the woods.
That, that, innuendo. Hey, there you go. You,
that's the next movie. That's the next movie where Cyrus fucks it up.
I'm sorry. Did I piss on your childhood?
Yes.
Nah, this is a very sweet movie, man. I love the way it does seem random, but it's all tied up, like all these complicated adventures they have, all to wrap back up with Pooh finally getting his honey one way or another.
And spoiler.
Yeah, come on now. Come on. It's like,
that's the biggest spoiler of all. He doesn't get his honey ever.
I want to say something because I know that it's not a real spoiler, but yet
technically
you are right.
It is very much technically my ass.
Who else would know more than Leon? Yeah.
People know. I mean, this always happens to Pooh. He always fires a honey. This ain't nothing new.
What if this is the one where it wasn't going
to
happen?
You are not going to do this to me. I am not guilty of the crimes that you say.
This movie was a game changer.
You open this up saying this movie is about Pooh's search for honey, and then later you go on to say, and so when he finds the honey, whoa, what the hell, man?
Well, at least I didn't tell them that everybody dies in this. You know, so, right. Yeah. No, you know, man.
Well, someday.
Toys will never die.
When Christopher Robin grows up and becomes a pyromaniac, starts burning his old toys to try to fit in with the cool gang at school.
Yeah, you know, that's the crazy thing, because it is the imaginary world of a small boy named Christopher Robin. In his room, he is a collector of many things.
He's a hoarder.
Yeah, he's a hoarder on the rise, but his favorite thing to hoard are his stuffed animals. And so the animals in the 100-acre wood, meaning his fucked up mind, are all
the
these
kids going to have an even more fucked up time when he gets older.
Yeah, he's kind of insane. And all these animals,
he's due for some hard times.
You start to think like he doesn't have any friends, so that's why he talks to these animals all the time, these stuffed animals.
My theory is starting to sound a little more realistic, huh?
I think this is like the prequel to Son of Sam.
Because I know if I was Christopher Robin, my father would have came here, boy, what you doing all these stuffed animals? That's for girls. This shit on out of my house. Yeah. Better pick up a football or something. No son of mine.
And that one red balloon that you just and that you one insist red balloon. On having
oh,
all the
time. You like these stuffed animals, huh, boy? Want me to buy you a dress now? You want to get a perm? Is that what you want, boy?
Winnie the Pooh, not Winnie the neighborhood crack hoe.
Not yet. But you know what? People, in spite of all of my joking, I just have to say, I can make some small quibbles about this film. But really, if I complain about anything, it's just like, saying, well, there's nothing like very eventful here when you think of movies these days, because we have a tendency to think of children's films now as being some overblown CG movie with a lot of
celebrity voices and remakes of popular songs from the 70s and
80s. Yeah, they have the latest pop song that they have to sell through that film. There's always pop culture references there. They have to jam adult humor in there to appeal to the parents that brought them in.
Let me redirect you to Cars 2.
Yeah. Well, you know, and even Cars 2 didn't do all that. Cars 2 was just, you know, suffered from being extremely plain to the point of just being uninspired and bad. But this movie right here, it's a sweet little film that the songs in the movie, which by the way are some of them, there's three songs done by Zooey Deschanel.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah. Well, one of them like composed by got her partner that's in the band.
She did at least the ending credits, and
she sang Winnie the Pooh.
I think she did the very beginning. Yeah.
Yeah, and you know, there's so the songs are really spectacular, but in the context of this being, because this truly is a children's film, and it works as a children's film. I mean, they're fun songs for little kids. This movie was very sweet, and I walked out of it in the best mood, and I loved it for that. Really, in a time where we're getting things like Smurfs and all these movies where we feel like we got to take these characters and put them like in an urban setting so that we can connect with them. This movie doesn't do that. It would really be hard pressed for me to give this anything other than a full price. I mean, even at the movie tonight, I don't like to judge audiences. I really don't. Because that I don't like to use that as a meter, because they're different every time, and at a screening we know that's especially different. But I heard parents and adults, kids and adults, like
and us.
Grandparents and us, and kids and adults just in there having a good time. In fact, there was one guy.
Yeah, there's some middle-aged guy sitting behind us who was narrating the entire movie.
Oh, he was not. You know what? I was fine with that because he was having a great time.
You know what? It is the new thing for me where I'm stuck, where part of me wants to go like, dude, come on, you're not at home. Knock it off. But like, man, he is having such a good time. I don't want to rain on his parade.
Like that part when Pooh fell into the pit, and then you could tell the honey pot was going to fall next, and that guy behind him like, on the head. Yeah, and I was like, man, this guy's having a good time. And he had no kids.
I know. That was the thing.
Yeah, I looked behind
me. That's the sad part. That's when you got to feel really bad for the guy.
Full of kids who were like noisy before the movie started, and they were totally chilled out when the movie was playing. And, you know, because this was the movie that talked to them. If you happen to take Big Sister, a big brother to see, you know, some other film, and you got the little toddler with you or the small child, I don't think you'd be disappointed escorting them into this movie. It's a really good time, and also it's short. It's 63 minutes. They even had to like tack a short before this to give it like appropriate feature length running time. So yeah, full price for me, man.
I was shocked in as much as like that short that comes before it. I didn't care for that at all. And that trailer for the Muppets movie, I think is just bland.
I heard you groaning.
It just makes me go like, man, I don't know why y'all are excited about this.
Early pre-review of it.
So I was more than pleasantly surprised by this movie. And you know, you guys bring up Cars 2 and Smurfs. Those are movies they're making because they want to make some money.
Yeah.
And here's a movie they seem to have made because they wanted to make the movie.
And make some money, but...
Well, I mean, yeah, if they make money, fine.
They didn't take away the integrity of the film.
Not at all. It never felt like a cash grab. It was just like, hey, there's something nice we put together. Enjoy it. And I did. You know, for that's being 63 minutes, you know, that's short. But it's like, man, that's thankfully short. I mean, it really got in and it got out with just the right amount of time. Didn't leave me, you know, there was no lag in it. And, you know, I mean, a lot of bang for that, for its buck. I mean, just, you know, mostly based on that, it comes in as a low full price to me. I mean, especially for a kid's movie. I mean, maybe for myself, I'm thinking matinee, but yeah, it was like the thing that I just kind of needed. It was one of the more enjoyable movies I've seen this year. Yeah. And really took me by surprise. So
no, I'm going to be the guy.
I know you're going to be the guy.
And I hate this because I think that as a film and with what this film is intending to be and who it's trying to be it for, it's near perfect for that. I mean, it's a film for toddlers. It really is. And it's a great message film. It's got the exact right sense of humor for them. These kids were loving it. We had an audience full of kids who were with this movie every step of the way, and you could totally tell why. There was not any, as you said, humor that was more directing towards adults or sidelines for adults, and that's where I have to go, okay, this is great for them. It didn't do much for me. I'm watching, I'm like, yeah, I laughed every once in a while, but this is directed at really young kids or people who are really nostalgic for Winnie the Pooh from when they grew up, and I don't even remember watching Winnie the Pooh when I grew up, so I don't have any nostalgia for it. I guess, I don't know. I mean, it's like I said, I can't fault it in any way, but at the same time, the best I can really give it is a matinee.
You damn sourpuss.
You asshole. Oh, you got to be a dick, man.
I'm sorry. Like, I feel like I should give it something
some
better.
Weed?
But I didn't really enjoy it all that much.
Well, that's for you. You were fair.
Bouncing out the sides.
You're like, I'm going to be that guy. That's not being that guy.
No, I didn't. There's nothing to hate about this. It's just like, I don't think I would tell like a 16-year-old, yeah, dude, you're going to love Winnie the Pooh. Because you're not.
Are you kissing his ass, Leon?
I would take a 16-year-old gangbanger this because I know he'd be sitting there like, it was beautiful. Where am I going with my life? Yeah. Everything I need to know, I can learn from Pooh.
I know.
I wish I didn't shoot that kid. I should have just been mellow about it.
Yeah, man. If I didn't, I wouldn't have killed that guy had Pooh taught me that.
Oh, wow. Well, you're one of those kids from...
As soon as that guy learns from
a better life.
A better life,
as soon as that guy learns that lesson, he walks out. Bam! Killed on the street.
And it's Pooh that did it. Fuck you, bitch.
He's more like, when's this bear going to transform into something?
I have to admit, this movie was a fresh breath air for me, especially with all the summer
fresh
crazy...
Breath air?
I mean, a breath of fresh air.
Sorry. I thought you were making a joke, and I was...
No.
Okay. Sorry.
But I was completely just amazed by the talent that worked on this movie. I mean, the animation, I have to say, is pretty damn impressive. Yeah. I loved how it looked. I mean, I know it's probably done on a computer, but it just looked like traditional hand animation.
No, it is hand-drawn animation.
If I
can just tell you, yeah. I mean, John Lasseter, for all the shit we gave him about Cars 2, John Lasseter is pretty much dedicated to 2D animation. You know, he
really
wants to see it out there. Yeah.
Fooled me.
I mean, and this is one of those projects where he thought, like, this is perfect to actually bring to the theater. I mean, it's Winnie the Pooh. We're keeping it very traditional. And, yeah, it is. I mean, now, today, they do certain things in computers. Like, we don't really use cells anymore.
You're right. They colored it.
They use computer paint for this and all this. But as far as the animation itself, yeah, it's pretty much traditional.
Well, you know what? It impressed the living hell out of me, and it was just refreshing to see that. And I'm glad they are not completely done with that. I mean, this movie is a testament to, you know, let other studios know, hey, you know, don't give up on this. It still looks beautiful on screen. And as far as the humor, I don't want to say, I mean, yeah, it's directed towards kids, obviously. But honestly, think any adult would enjoy the hell out of this, because I sure as hell did. I was laughing throughout this whole movie. These characters are enjoyable. I'm not a Winnie the Pooh fan, but this movie actually, it makes me want to be. It makes me want to look at all the movies before it, if you're saying they're as good as they are. But it was just a great family film. This is probably one of the best family films I've seen in a long time, since Toy Story, I'd say.
Yeah.
I definitely put it up there. And, you know, I was on the verge of giving it Better Than Sex, but I mean, like I said, it wraps itself up so nicely. I think it's just a nice full price.
I think you could be arrested for giving Winnie the Pooh a Better Than Sex.
I was thinking about that. I was like, sex with who?
Maybe that's my robot gut telling me, you know, just keep it cool. No need to go visit the slammer tonight. It was really awe-inspiring watching a movie like this, especially in this day and age, get made. And notice like the audience really love it, really enjoy it for what it is, which is just pure family entertainment in the purest sense of it.
Yeah, you don't have to be given adult humor on the slide to enjoy this. This is meant to be, like, I guess, bring out the childhood in you.
It does. And it really does. It really does.
That's what's so refreshing about it, is that it could be so good without even a hint of cynicism. I'm so used to seeing cartoons. Most cartoons I watch are for adults. They have some kind of shock value to them.
Yeah.
And I only just recently started to realize, like, maybe I'm getting kind of tired of that. And seeing this is like, yeah, I just want something good.
You're right. I mean, maybe that's what it is. You get completely, like, you know, drowned in all the what everyone's trying to make you think is cool these days, where it's like, no, you know, like I said, there's a reason why certain properties work, and this is the great example of it.
Yeah, that was a wonderful film, man.
I would not be shocked if like Oscar comes around, you see this in the running, honestly.
Well, Pixar's going to get that.
Well, you know,
they paid for the next 10 years.
But saying that, though, I'm hoping that this movie does well, only because, you know, you got Harry Potter coming out, and I hope it doesn't get drowned out by the rest of these films out. People really do need to see this, I think.
Well, I mean, this is the kids' film for kids who are too young for Harry Potter, quite frankly, because the new Harry Potter is pretty dark and violent.
That's true. It is more of an adult film.
And by the way, stick around to the very end. There is a scene at the very end which is hilarious. Yeah, you guys. I was sitting there just going, oh, those dumbasses.
I know, man. You came in.
It was great. I told you about it. Yeah.
Now I got to go see it on Friday again.
It was hilarious, man. Yeah.
Now I got to look like a child molester, man. Going to see Winnie the Pooh by myself at midnight, even.
Exactly.
Eeyore coveting the cosmic cube. Is that what it is?
Yeah. Just dress up as Eeyore when you go.
You know what? You made a great point by saying there's no big celebrity voice, and there's only three here, if you even want to count them as big. John Cleese as a narrator,
right.
Tom Kenny as Rabbit, and maybe another character, and then
Tom Kenny, he's a voice actor.
He does that all the time.
One voice actor I noticed, because I was leaving, I went to see who they were, and the actor who did the voice of Piglet, Kanga, and Roo is Bruce W. Smith, who was the director of The Proud Family, that cartoon series.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I was just like, wow. I guess he's still in the Disney stable. He doesn't have his own cartoon anymore, but just doing voices.
Well, there's a lot of people. The guy who does Pooh's voice, Jim Cummings, has been doing voices for Disney cartoons and animation since the 80s.
He's not the original voice
of Pooh,
I see. Is he?
No, that guy.
He sounds so much like us.
He nails it.
Yo, yeah, that guy's dead. Yeah. Who did the red?
I can imagine a 90-year-old guy in that room doing voices.
It freaks me out because he sounds identical. like the guy who's trying to be Tigger. What was that actor? Paul Winchell used to do Tigger's voice. And, you know, Paul Winchell's dead. And the new guy doing Tigger, you know, I mean, he does the best somebody could do. You can still tell it's not him. But Winnie the Pooh, I'm like, God damn.
Oh, you know, it's Jim Cummings who does Pooh, who also does Tigger. So that guy does a lot.
Is it? I thought they had somebody else's name on
it. No, that guy does a lot of voices.
Okay, he's one of those.
And they kind of think, like, oh, this guy's dead. Get Jim in here and let him do that voice. And Yeah, I was surprised to see Craig Ferguson. I mean, do a voice. Yeah. Craig Ferguson's starting to do a voice.
How to Train Your Dragon.
How to Train Your Dragon in this. Yeah. And I must mention that he also had a drinking and, I think, drug problem. So it all, you know, comes full circle.
It all makes sense. It relates to this property.
Oh, bother. Perhaps I could borrow some honey. Just a taste, or a small lick, I should think.
Silly old bear. Somewhere.